Good morning, Trina. And good morning to everyone else, and welcome here this morning as we'll let everyone get seated. And if you have your Bible here, or you want to tap to it or whatever, Psalm 91, I'll be reading from New Living Translation. But before we get to that, just go through a couple of the announcements to highlight here. One is that tomorrow night is the annual meeting, and rumor has it Tim hasn't had pie since the last annual meeting. I'm not sure if that's a how real. I was wondering. Yeah. So there will be pie after the annual meeting tomorrow night. So if you make it in here, that would be great. As well as, what was the other one that? Oh, yeah. So as many are probably aware, it was over 2 years ago at the start of March, probably the Sunday being probably March 1st, I think, was our last time we actually served communion. So we'll be serving it here today. If you're not comfortable with that, there is a station at the back. Please feel free to make yourself to that. But otherwise, the elders will be serving communion today here. So, which is, for me, something just pretty amazing to be able to do again. So, Psalm 91. When Phil asked me to read this one, I told him, I said, you know, that's one that I've almost got the entire psalm highlighted over the years now. And at first, you know, it'd be a highlight one verse here, one verse there. And then as I started to read it more and more in the whole, it was like, really the key for me comes down to the end verse. So if you have your Bible, please follow along. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust him. For he will rescue you from every trap and protect you from deadly disease. He will cover you with his feathers. He will shelter you with his wings. His faithful promises are your armor and protection. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrows that fly in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in the darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Though 1,000 fall at your side, though 10,000 are dying around you, these evils will not touch you. Just open your eyes and see how the wicked are punished. If you make the Lord your refuge, if you make the Most High your shelter, no evil will conquer you, no plague will come near you, near your home. For he will order his angels to protect you wherever you go. They will hold you up with their hands, so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. You will trample upon the lion and the cobras. You will crush fierce lions and serpents under your feet. The Lord says, those who love me, the Lord says, I will rescue those who love me. I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. And like I said, it's the last verse, the end game, that's important for me. Yeah, life is going to have a lot of stuff involved. And if we get caught up looking at the circumstances, things can look pretty dire. But I just know that it's like when I was in the Army and we were finishing up a recruit term. You look to finish that race so that in that case, you could actually eat a full meal. Like after 2 months, a full meal was a wonderful thing to have. And it pales in comparison to the gift of salvation that we'll have as whenever that occurs for each of us, and the final gift of being with Jesus is just something incredible to me. So let's take some time and pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we can come again here before you. I thank you for just being able to freely worship you. Father, I pray that you would just calm any anxious hearts that are here, Father. Allow us to focus on you and just to bring honor to you through our worship. Father, I thank you so much for Wes and Michelle and Skylar, Father, for Wes and Michelle's faithfulness in serving you, Father, and for the incredible gift of art that you've given Sky. Father, I also thank you for Dawn and Lorna, that you just, again, the incredible faith you've instilled in them and that they keep building into their family around them and their grandchildren, Father. Thank you again so much for their faithfulness. Father, I pray for the church at Grassy Plain, Father, and Carrot River as well, that as they meet, again, it might be just a celebration again of your body coming together and worshiping you. Father, thank you so much for Damien and Emily, Father, and just be with them as they continue to serve in Costa Rica, Father, that they would, their ministries would be effective, and Father, they would be encouraged. Thank you again, Father, just for an amazing day here. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Good morning. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning and to actually see you. Just thinking back, I think this might be the first time that I've been up on this end of the microphone and actually seen everybody. And so, yeah, for some of you, I don't recognize some of you. So if you're new here, welcome. And if I'm new here, then, or if I'm new to you here. But, I will invite you to stand with us this morning as we sing praise to our Lord and our God. In Christ alone. Oh. Sorry, time out. I think I started in the wrong key inadvertently. So that could have. You guys sounded amazing though, just so you know. In Christ alone, my hope is found, and He is my life, my strength.
Power of hell, no scheme of man can ever play.
John 3:16 to 18 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son." And this is what we want to sing about. Just God saved us. It is, yeah. Just praise. That's all we have to give. You see the mountain.
your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible.
Psalm 84. Just take that off. I don't need it because you guys are crushing it. So Psalm, I'm not going to read the whole Psalm. I'm just going to read the first few verses, and then part of the Psalm you're probably familiar with as well. And then I just want to share a little bit from a sermon that I had heard part of this week. But so Psalm 84:11 starts with, "How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God." And then it continues on. And then starting at verse 10 and 11, it says, "For a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. And this is the part that wrestle with a little bit. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the one who trusts in you. And the thing that stands out for that is, you know, it says, no good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. And I know in my heart and in my mind, I go, but bad things happen to me. Bad things happen. Vehicles break down. I get sick or whatever it would be, right? We can probably all come up with things that, God, why this? And, you know, we're going to sing the song, Goodness of God. And so the sermon I'd heard, a lady that was sharing, she had a stroke. She's been in a wheelchair for 14 years. She was a young mom at the time. And so she shared this excerpt from Sir Richard Baker from the 17th century. And here he talks about the goodness of God. But how is this true when God oftentimes withholds riches and honors and health of body from men, though they walk ever so uprightly? We may therefore know that honors and riches and bodily strength are none of God's good things. The good things of God are chiefly peace of conscience, the joy in the Holy Ghost in this life, or the Holy Spirit, fruition of God's presence, and vision of his blessed face in the next. And these good things God never bestows upon the wicked and never withholds from the godly. It's not our circumstances that we sing of the goodness of God. We know God. He is here with us. He has sent his Spirit with us, and we have the hope beyond this life. That is the goodness of God. So I just ask you, as we sing the goodness of God this morning, that's what we focus on. Not our circumstances, because we all probably have a laundry list of things that we could say, God, why? Why? But we wanted to focus on God's goodness.
My life, you have been so, so good.
thank you so much. Lord, we thank you for your gift of salvation. Lord, we thank you for your promises that you will never leave us nor forsake us. Father, we thank you for this morning. We just pray and ask that as Phil speaks your word to us this morning, God, that our hearts would be receptive to hear what you want to do and change in our lives. In Jesus' name.
Going to do the minutes for the ministry moment this morning. I'm going to call up Afifa so she could come up here. And she's currently a student at Nipawin Bible College and originally from Ontario. And she's going looking forward to a future ministry of Northern Canada Evangelical Mission and looking to, has actually been serving at Big River Bible Camp last summer, and I think next summer too, I think. So again, she's looking forward to ministry at the Canada Evangelical Mission. And I've talked to her on the phone a couple times, and she has a pretty amazing testimony. So I think you'll really, really appreciate what she has to say. So we'll give her this time to share and to speak about what the Lord has laid in her heart.
Would you just pray for us just before we begin?
Oh, sure.
Perfect. Thank you.
Lord Jesus, thank you for Afifa. Thank you for her ministry. Thank you for the way you've worked in her life to bring her to yourself. And Lord, you have done so many amazing things. We just sang about that, singing of the goodness of God. And Lord, you have been so good to so many of us. And in Afifa and her life too, you've really worked in her and just been really strong and powerful there. So as she shares this morning, I pray just give her just the right words to say that would be encouraging and strengthening for all of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah. I was like, let's try this. It was not working out. All right. So thank you guys for giving me this opportunity to just share with you all the things, not all, but just some of the things that God has done in my life so far. So obviously, my name is Afifa. Afifa Faruqi. I was born in Saudi Arabia. And I have four older siblings. I come from a Pakistani and an Arabian like background. And my family and I, we immigrated to Canada when I was about 1 year old. So we grew up in Toronto. At least I grew up in Toronto, in a very traditional Muslim home. And I was immersed in a culture that held family honor above everything else. And I left my biological family's home when I was 17 years old, and I actually began living with my best friend's family. So despite living in Toronto in a very multicultural environment, they were actually the first Christians I had ever met. And it's through them that I began attending church, Bible studies, and youth group every week. And so when I left home, my life absolutely fell apart. Just fell apart. And it's actually through this church community that took me in, gave me some of their time, opened up their homes to me, loved me, told me, you know, through their words, through their actions, just genuinely that they loved me. And they prayed for me behind the scenes. Like, even before they knew me, they were praying for me. You know, like even when they didn't know what was going on in my head, in my heart, and in my personal life, they were praying for me. And all of this played a huge role in how God taught me about who he is. That, like all of that is just how my eyes were opened to the love that the Father has for me that I had actually never experienced before in my life. And I began to wonder why God would, why Christians actually, why people would choose to believe in Christianity, why people would choose to believe in this triune God rather than any of the other existing religions. And it's in this state of mind that I had my first experience at Big River Bible Camp. And my first experience at Bible Camp actually ever. I didn't even know but Bible camps were a thing. Yep. And so in 2016, I happened to receive an opportunity to volunteer as a leader in training at Big River Bible Camp in, obviously, Big River, Saskatchewan. And there, children from ages 8 to 12 talked about how Jesus made their lives better. And many of them said that 1 week of camp in the summer was what kept them from committing suicide that year. During this week, these campers, they learned about how they are conquerors through God, through Him. And I could see with my own eyes the change that occurred in them throughout that 1 week, throughout those 6 days. It was so, like, abundantly clear that 1 week was the 1 week that they found hope. And throughout the 3 years that I left home to when I was at Big River, like, there was 3 years in between then. Throughout those 3 years, experiencing the burden of my own sin, and while previously being in a religion and culture that was incredibly works-based, just illuminated the beauty of our Father's grace, the free gift of forgiveness, and his gift of Jesus' birth, death, and resurrection. And it's in 2018, when I was 19 years old, that I accepted Jesus as my Lord and as my Savior. And I was baptized that following week. In 2019, after experiencing 3 weeks of camp in just 3 years, all I wanted was to be at camp for more than 1 week. That is all I wanted. And that too before heading off into my next year at nursing school. And so I ended up being Big River's first intern that summer. And by the end of those 4.5 months, I realized God's calling on my life. It wasn't nursing. It was full-time career ministry with the parent organization of Big River Bible Camp, Northern Canada Evangelical Missions, or NCEM. Yeah, so now I'm candidating with NCEM, and I'm in my second year at Nipawin Bible College, and I'm currently in preparation for full-time ministry in April 2023 after completing my third year of school. So at this point in our lives, in light of all the things that we have learned over the past, especially year, it is not a secret that the majority of our Indigenous population live in poverty, and they experience generational abuse that just results in hopelessness and ultimately, very often, suicide as well. Together, I truly believe that we can work together to fulfill God's commission on each of our lives as Christians, as believers, as His children, through sharing the gospel to meet the practical and the spiritual needs of our First Nations populations. And that is where NCEM comes in. NCEM is an interdenominational faith organization, and we seek to bring the gospel to Canada's First Nations populations. And as an NCEM missionary, my job has two parts. Number one, I'll be spreading awareness through speaking at various Christian organizations, churches, creating videos, and giving a voice to both the physical and the spiritual needs of our First Nations families. Also, what NCEM is doing and how the body of Christ can get involved. And secondly, through intentional relationships. So I will be serving on staff at Big River Bible Camp through intentionally discipling and mentoring our female volunteers throughout the year, not just the camp season. And so this particular summer that's coming up, I'll be working full-time at Big River, likely serving as an assistant director. And after my third year at Nipawin Bible College, I plan to begin serving full-time and year-round, as well as helping run our off-season programming on the reserves. One story that I would like to share with you actually entails an 18-year-old teenager that was at Bible Camp, at Big River Bible Camp, during my internship in 2019. After registration, as all the campers and I were at the playground, I noticed that something was off about him. When I asked him if everything was okay, he sat me down and shared that after graduating, which itself is a big deal, he partied for 4 days and four nights straight. And the morning before arriving at camp, he tied a noose around his neck and he hung himself. He told me that right before he did it, he cried out to God saying, "God, if I'm not meant to die, save me. If I have a purpose in this world, save me. And if I'm loved, save me." And that's when he blacked out. He then pulled back his hood, and I saw the extent of the bruises and cuts on his neck. That is a sight that I will never forget. But that also showed me God's grace. Together, we read 1 Corinthians 13, 4 to 8, and we replaced the word love with God. If God is love, as 1 John says, and love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it is not self-seeking, and we know this passage, then God is all of those things as well. And I told him, this is just a small example of the way that God loves you. And I reiterated, here it says that God never fails. If you believe that the Bible is truth, then this fact is truth. God never fails. And you pray to God saying that if you're worth anything to save you, if you're loved to save you, and here you are, you're alive. Do you think that that's a coincidence? And this teen committed his entire summer to serving at camp for the first time since he was 14. Even leading several other campers to the Lord, he began looking into attending Bible college, and both of us are currently in our second year at Nipawin Bible College. This is all by the grace of God. And he used someone like I was just a vessel. And This story is just one of the many. I can tell you so many, like a number of heartbreaking stories, one after another, about the realities and the trauma of the children and youth that come to our camp. But not only at our camp, just in Saskatchewan, in the Prairie Provinces, in Canada. And as great and effective as camp is at bringing the good news to children and youth that are desperately in need, we are also in need of people available to pursue these youth year-round while they're living at home. And I believe that God has led me to use the gifts and the story that he's given me to spur these youth on towards hope, towards freedom, and living into their calling as children just wonderfully, preciously, beautifully made in his image. But not only living those lives just at camp, but year round, and being that light in their home community, in their own families, in their own friend groups. And so I would like to invite you as a church to partner with me in ministry to share in this work, making disciples of all nations and sharing this good news, beginning with those desperately in need in our own homes, in our own backyard. And that's why I'm here. In this partnership, each of us would have a role. So my role would be to, number one, be your hands and feet that is extended to our Indigenous communities. And secondly, I want to be sure that I'm communicating with you, and so I'll send you newsletters quarterly. And thirdly, I want to be praying for you guys, your individual families, and our church family as well. Your role would be first and foremost to, number one, pray with me. Pray with me for our volunteers, for our campers, for our staff. And secondly, I would ask that you make a financial commitment as you're led for a long-term sustainable ministry. And number three, and finally, I would encourage you to share the stories of this of the need and of the hope that I hope to share with you all. As I commit to being your hands and feet that is extended to our Indigenous communities. And so, this is the partnership that I'm just extending to you all. And so I have a table set up in the back over there. And please, like, I'll be staying around after service. Please don't hesitate to talk to me. I have prayer cards there, some amazing, genuinely phenomenal pens. I am so serious. I got about 3 rose golds. Oh, they're so good. So take the pens, take the suckers, take the stuff. There's shirts there as well. Take the prayer cards. Continue to pray for us. And if you have any questions, please, like, let me know. But before I leave off, I would like to leave you guys with a prayer request. My dad is not Christian. He's Muslim, and he's actually on pilgrimage right now. He's ending, his pilgrimage ends in Saudi Arabia in 2 days. And so I would just love it if you guys prayed for my dad while he's in Saudi Arabia, just that while he's trying to grow closer to Allah, that he would find God, that he would just believe. He knows the gospel message. He knows about the Bible. And so please just be praying along with me that when he comes back, that he's a changed man. And so with that, I'll close. Thank you.
Zikaula. Okay, let's pray for him. Lord, thank you for Afifa. Thank you for the privilege of meeting together today. Lord, we pray for Afifa's father. And we ask, Lord, that as he searches for something he believes to be valuable, I pray that you would meet him in that place. And I pray, Lord, that you would reveal your truth to him. Lord, Afifa says he knows the message. And Lord, we know your promise that your word does not return void. And so, Lord, we just commit Zakola to you. We ask that, Jesus, that you would meet him on his pilgrimage, just as you met Saul, as he was going to do something that was not according to your glory, that you met him and changed him. And we just commit him to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, thanks, Afifa. Karina, come on up.
Good morning. My name is Karina Stevenson, and I'm the prayer coordinator here at Park Avenue. And wow, I loved hearing your testimony. And it actually brought me some confirmation this morning, because each week I custom design a prayer sheet for Park Avenue by intentionally seeking the Holy Spirit. And this week I felt I heard the Holy Spirit tell me to pray a line from a Grinch movie. My kids love The Grinch, and I was like, this doesn't seem scriptural. But anyways, it was, pray that Park Avenue's heart, like The Grinch's, would grow 3 sizes that day. And so I've been praying that all week, and thank you for the confirmation that was a genuine prayer. And where that prayer came from is really that God is just. That was the theme that Pastor Phil gave me this week. And so I'm going to tell you a little story to set the context for our prayer time, and then I'm going to walk you through all the homework that I have done in the last 2 weeks since I seen you last. Okay, so when I became a Christian about 6 years ago, I felt like that was my encounter with Jesus, is that almost instantaneously my heart did grow 3 sizes. I think I've shared before that one of the things that the Lord led me to do was to volunteer at an orphanage, but he also placed new eyes in me to just see the needs around me here in Malfort and in Saskatoon, wherever I was. And so I began just really being very aware of vulnerable people, needy people. And one of the things I admire most about my husband is that he's very generous. And so he really fanned into flame this new heart that I had. but encourage me not to give people money, but instead to make care packages that we could deliver. And so whenever we go anywhere, I have these packages, and all my family helps me. In fact, if they see somebody, they'll say, "Do you have a package to give out?" And we've thrown it out of the car window as we've drove by people, or we've squealed, mostly my husband squealed across lanes to give it to people and sort of get grumpy at people that are honking at us on the way by. And the other thing that has happened to me a few times is that the Holy Spirit has prompted me to give money. I do this very seldomly, but I'll tell you one story, quick story, just so that you can understand the context. I was in the grocery store here at the co-op in Melfort, and this lady with three young children was behind me, and I felt so strongly that I was supposed to pay for her groceries. But I didn't really know how to do this, and it seemed awkward to me. In honest truth, I was having some wrong thoughts, judgmental thoughts. Well, what if she uses the money for drugs or whatever it was? And I felt really ashamed. So when I left the parking, when I left the store and in the parking lot, I was praying to God. I was like, "I'm so sorry if I've missed this opportunity. If this was from you, give me another chance." So normally I don't grocery shop on Saturdays, but 3 days later I needed something. I went into the co-op, was in the line, and would you believe it that this lady with her three kids was right behind me again. I was like, "Yahoo, I can do this." So I had a gift card, and I had the whole plan now, so I was going to give the teller the gift card, pay for her groceries, and it would just be a simple loving act as not to put any kind of embarrassment on her. So I gave the gift card to the teller and explained, "Can you put this and use it to pay for the lady's groceries behind me?" And she rings through my groceries. I look, oh, she's put the gift card on my groceries. Oh, I'm just devastated. I'm trying to do this. So again, I left the grocery store saying, "Well, I've grown, my heart's growing, but it still didn't work out for me." So I said, "Lord, if I was supposed to give this lady money, can you please make her cross my path again?" And I just barely looked up from putting my card away, and here comes the lady with her three kids walking right beside me. And so I gave her the money, and I had a card in my wallet that said, "Prayer changes everything." And so I'm sure she thinks I'm a lunatic, but I said, "The Holy Spirit told me I've been trying to pay for your groceries. So here's this money and this card about how prayer changes everything." And I prayed for her and her kids and went on my day. Now, I don't say these things to brag about myself or anything. I'm still really growing. But I say them for two reasons, because this week I felt like the Holy Spirit wanted me to remind us to take heart that God is just and that we should always err on the side of being generous and let God do the judging with people about whether or not they're using our resources rightly or wrongly. And if you feel prompted, follow it. It's just such a blessing. And the second thing that I wanted to say is that prayer is the first step to justice. So none of these things happened in my life, but every morning I prayed, "God, use me to bless others. Give me eyes to see the needs around me." I was so hardened, so self-absorbed in my own life that I never used to see these things. And I tell you, the honest truth is when I don't have one of these packages with me, I see the needs all around me. So with that, we're going to have some prayer time about justice. I have given you some prompts on your sheet, and I've done a kids section. I've also done something a little new today, which is that at the end of the prayer prompts, I've provided just a little space for praise. So when you see me come back on the stage before I close us in prayer, just signal that to take some time to praise God. For the kids, my mom and I, what we always did when we praised God was did the ABCs. So God is awesome, God is beautiful, God is caring, and on. It just helped us to do it. But I also have some other homework there that I'll just spend just a second telling you about. So one is I gave you a little copy of a prayer for the crisis in Ukraine. This has been so heavy on my heart, and I was really struggling to know how to pray. So I found some scriptural prayer that I thought was beautiful. Take it home with you. Put it on your fridge. And when you're like me and in discussion and really needing a scriptural promise from God to pray, it's there for you. Or if you feel led this morning, you can pray that prayer. And the other thing is, I believe Pastor Phil's been talking to you about doing a fast, a corporate fast. So I've put together a booklet for you. It did not print the way that I wanted it to. I wanted it to be a small booklet. But my desire to save trees outweighed my desire to impress you. So I've given it to you as it is. And I think it's really prominent. So if it's not speaking loud enough to you, just turn the page. The print is really big. So I really hope that you'll consider this. I really champion fasting. I'll tell you, I've failed at it. I've grown close to God in it. I've got more sensitive ears. And so I just want to be a resource to you. I don't have it all figured out. But if you want to talk more about it, I'm always here, or any of the leaders. The elders are really championing this for our congregation. So we're going to do that in March. So we'll talk a little bit more about it next week. So anyway, sorry to talk so long. I've obviously really missed you guys. The prompts are there. Use them as you see fit, or just seek the Holy Spirit. And then I'll come back up. When you see me, if you remember, just take that opportunity to take a praise break. Just thank God, praise Him for a minute, and then I'll close us in prayer. Okay? Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you are good. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you are worthy of all of our praise, that you are love, that you are grace, that your mercy triumphs over judgment, but that we do know that you are just. Lord, I just pray that you will use each of us at Park Avenue, Lord, to spread your love, Lord, and give each of us just brilliant, clear vision, Lord, of those that are vulnerable, those that are needy and oppressed, Lord, in our community. Lord, and I pray that you'll show each of us by the prompting of your Holy Spirit, Lord, how we can serve and reflect you, Lord, so that others will know and feel your love. Lord, we just again thank you for the love that you pour out on us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Invite the kids up for kids feature. It's good to see all of you guys again. So, last week, Pastor Phil talked to us all about fasting. Did any of you guys actually try to give up the things that you wrote down last week? A few of you. Good. You isn't that the story? Now, I think it was like something like 3/4 of you guys wrote down that you wanted to give up TV. Some of you, yeah, but you can't really give that up. It's not going to work out for you. Now, there's a lot of times where God will ask us to give something up or to obey Him, and it's really hard to do that, right? Like, sometimes if God asks us to give up TV, we can be like, I don't know, God, if I do that, then my life's going to be super boring. Like, what am I going to do? And it's hard to trust sometimes that God will be enough for us. Or even like other things, like, God, if I go and be friends with this kid, then what if everyone laughs at me too, just like they laugh at them? And sometimes trusting God is, a lot of times, trusting and obeying God is scary. It's kind of like, imagine if we're this ruler and we're worried, this is obeying. Worry that, oh, if we obey God, then this is what's going to happen to us. we're scared that we're just gonna fly, or I don't know, this something bad's gonna happen. Now, God has promised though that He's always gonna be with us. The Bible says that God is our anchor, our firm foundation. And so if we obey God and do scary things, He's promised that He'll always be with us. Now, if I put this piece of paper over this, what do you think will happen when I drop the eraser on there? You think the ruler won't fall down? You think it's going to launch the paper, right? Because how heavy is paper? How many of you guys can lift a piece of paper? Yeah, everyone. So if I drop an eraser on this ruler, I mean, obviously the piece of paper is just going to fly away, right? Now, sometimes, guys, this is what we think of like with our walk with God. Like, God's going to be with us. And we're like, oh, God, like, I know you're going to be with us, but like, this is really scary. And if I do this, I don't know. And like, I know you said you're always going to be with me, but this doesn't seem safe. So let's try it out and see what's going to happen, okay? You guys ready? No, look. Here, I'll try it again. It doesn't. The paper's heavier than this. Well, so I mean, like in this analogy, this is God. And then, so we obey Him and He's with us and he cares for us and He's our anchor. He holds fast even when tough times come or when scary things. Even so that like this is, it's not super heavy, but it should be enough to topple this. So this is a bag of Skittles. Do you think if we drop the Skittles on here, for sure that should topple the paper, right? I mean, is this heavier than a piece of paper? Yeah. By like a lot. Okay, so we'll see. I'm hoping that this works. Watching? Think we can try it again? Okay. Because with God, we can face way more than we could ever even imagine to face on our own. I'll do it even one more time just to show that it works. Crazy. Just one piece of paper. So sometimes trusting in God and obeying Him will seem scary and like, oh God, like this is all that I got. Only I have is You. And this is really scary. But when we trust God and obey Him, it may be scary, it may be hard, but we find that God is more than enough for us when we face tough times and we obey it and do scary things. So my question for you is actually a question that you guys have to ask someone else. So what I want you guys to do is to ask another adult, how has God been your anchor? So you write a summary of what they said on the piece of paper, and then you can trade it in afterwards. But so there's pieces of paper here and here. But right now, you need to ask an adult, how has God been your anchor? And then change it in, and then ages 3 to kindergarten are dismissed for Kids Live.
Who remembers that music? Oh yeah. How can you not? And you're welcome, it'll be in your head for the rest of the day. That's Robin Hood from 50 years ago. All right, 50 years ago, Disney made that movie. Actually, it was 49 years ago, in 1973. And it's easily one of the most recognizable tunes. If you were a kid and you grew up, you watched that movie, like, I remember it. In fact, when I'm bored and I'm walking around, it's coming out. It's my bored song. It's the thing that I whistle as I'm walking down, even in the office or whatever. It's such a good song. And it's such a good story. How many of you are fairly familiar with Robin Hood? Not necessarily the fox, although, Evie, you can put him up there just so you kind of get an idea. It's a story of this, well, it was a man, but a fox in Disney's anthropomorphic world, where this man robs from the rich and gives to the poor, right? It's a really inspirational story about a selfless person who's looking out for the little guy and who's also facing down, next slide, a horrible, usurping, thumb-sucking lion, I mean, Prince John, who is actually taking the place of the rightful king, whose name is Richard the Lionheart, right? And so these are anthropomorphic depictions, but so good. And thanks, Evie. You can mute the screen for now. I'll get you to show the map in a little bit. So as I read this week's passage, all I could think of was Robin Hood. That's it. All I could think of was how David is like the Bible's Robin Hood. And it was so interesting as I went through and like looked at the comparisons. We'll see David hide in a forest, save people in distress, be kind to refugees, and men who are down on their luck. They all gathered around David. And it's so neat to see how David hides in plain sight from his enemies, like Robin Hood did. He drives his enemies insane, like Robin Hood. It's just like it. And it's a pretty enjoyable passage, albeit with some kind of dark stuff hidden in there too, which is just, again, like that story. So if you have your Bible, you can go to 1 Samuel 22. Don't close it, because we're going to be reading big chunks of Scripture this morning. And I want to echo the same thing that our worship leader, Rob, has said. It's just good to see so many of you and good to see so many of you come back and to hear the volume in this building. It has not been like this for a few years. And it's pretty hard to keep it locked in and not get too emotional. Although it's good. It's just good because the Lord has brought us together and He's allowed us to worship together today. So, 1 Samuel 22, first five verses. So David left Gath and escaped to the cave of Adullam. Excuse me. Soon his brothers and all his other relatives joined him there. Then others began coming, men who were in trouble or in debt or who were just discontented, until David was the captain of about 400 men. Later, David went to Mizpah in Moab, where he asked the king, "Please allow my father and mother to live here with you until I know what God is going to do for me." So David's parents stayed in Moab with the king during the entire time David was living in his stronghold. One day, the prophet Gad told David, "Leave the stronghold and return to the land of Judah." So David went to the forest of Hereth. See, he's hiding in a forest. It's perfect. All right, now I know this is a setting the table chunk of the scripture, but it actually teaches us a number of really important things about this man David, about the God that he serves, and some really important principles that you and I need to keep in mind. All right, so I got more out of these five verses than I did out of the next two chapters, which we will still look at, but let me just kind of show you where we're at. Evie, if you can put that map up on the screen for me. We're going to keep this map up the whole time. It's really helpful because we often hear biblical names and we just are like, oh, that's great and that's great. And we never really think about where they're going. So David is at the cave of Adullam here, right here. All right. And Saul is at Gibeah. And there's a couple of other titles that we'll get there. But David is at Adullam. And then he goes to Mizpah, which is in Moab, way over here. All right, this is a long trip. It's completely out of the country of Israel. And so he's going to take his parents there, but the forest of Hereth is right between Adullam and Keilah. It's right in here. I couldn't find a map that would note that, but it's about 30 kilometers south of Adullam and 30 kilometers north of Keilah. And he's hiding in there where these men start coming. Starts with his family, and then word spreads. And these men who are discontented or in debt or whatever start coming. And I don't know exactly why they came to David, but I'm betting that it is, again, similar to Robin Hood, where these men are disenfranchised, they're in debt, they're discouraged about where their country is going, and so they go and find David. Maybe they knew from David's family that he was anointed as the next king of Israel, the true king of Israel. For whatever reason, these 400 men find David, and it actually highlights a really important theme that I want you to see throughout the next two chapters of Scripture, which is that those who seek, find. Those who seek, find. You'll see this theme come out amazingly as we go through these next two chapters. So although it seems like David is the outlaw, I've compared him to an outlaw in this passage, he's not the outlaw. And it's important for us to remember that. David is actually the guy who's in the right. He's being pursued by the guy who's in the wrong. David is God's man. He loves God. He's chosen by him. Come on over, Lauren. I forgot. Actually, my jar is right here. Never mind, but thank you. So you saw, and so now David, the man in the right, needs to protect people around him. So he takes his parents and he goes way over to the east into Moab, and he parks his parents there at the stronghold of a foreign king. And that's a pretty interesting thing for a king of Israel, or at least the up-and-coming king of Israel, to do, is depend on somebody who is very likely going to be a rival or somebody he's going to go after later. So they must have had some kind of good relationship that we're not really sure about. But he takes his parents to Moab, and and I think it's a great picture of how we as Christians need to be, given the times and the world that we live in and the times that we're facing. All right, now, like it or not, the last 2 years have been difficult, to say the least, and they have, in some ways, highlighted Christians as people who are extremists. I'm not saying that of anybody in this room or pointing any fingers at all, but it is fairly obvious that there were some Christians out there who took the last 2 years, ran with it in a direction that was very dramatic. And even if you take COVID and the reaction to COVID out of the equation for the church, the values that the church stands on, the things that we believe, that we hold strongly to, are becoming more and more increasingly out of favor. Would you agree with that? That the things we believe, that the Word of God tells us, are becoming increasingly unpopular, not increasingly more accepted. It's a sign of the times that we live in. And we see David preparing for this in his time by helping his family to safety. And I think we see God's character in David as he does that, protecting the vulnerable. His parents could be used for hostages going forward. And and so now we need to think about what we need to do to prepare for the next coming months and years, or however long the Lord has us on this earth. One gigantic step, man, drink this water the wrong way or the right way, it doesn't matter. We've seen a gigantic step in COVID and everything, hopefully coming to a close here. But that doesn't mean that God's plan for shaking the earth up is over. If you take one step, it just means that there's another step coming. And I don't know what that step looks like. But my question to you is, are you ready for that step? Are you ready for whatever God has for us next? And I don't know what that is. Maybe it's a time of quiet. Maybe it's a time of major upheaval. I don't know. I don't know God's timeline. I do know that his plan is marching forward. And I know that we need to be ready. We need to look at the world. We need to look at our country. We need to look at our province and our community and read the signs and be prepared for whatever God has for us. That's what David is doing by putting his parents in a safe place. I'm not advocating that we just stay safe, but I'm advocating that we be ready for what God has for us. I find David's next move fascinating as well. David stays there in Moab with his parents for a little while until the Lord says to him through a prophet, he says, okay, it's time to go. And I'm not really sure, because David does say, I'm going to live here until I know what God is going to do for me. I wonder if David was looking for a little bit more than go, just leave. I think he might have been waiting for something a little more specific. I know that I would have been waiting for something a little more specific than go and live in the forest and wait some more. And I think that we see David just a little bit comfy here. I'm not 100%, but this is kind of my read on it, is that, you know, David gets his safety, he gets them out of Israel, and then he just kind of sits for a little bit. And I think we all understand that. I think we actually even advocate for it from time to time. We have phrases for it. Take a break. Do something for you. And the ever popular, be kind to yourself. Whatever you want to say. David's been on the run for his whole, like for his life and for a long time. He's the right guy and he's in the right and he's had it super hard. I mean, it would be nice to just take it easy once in a while. Maybe he could just put up his feet for a little while and just chill. But God doesn't want that. God is calling him to action. God has put David as the king of Israel. He's the rightful king of Israel, and there's an unworthy man ruling in his place right now. God has things for David to do, so he sends word and says, hey, it's time to get going. And so David doesn't hesitate. He just goes, right? So he has no idea where to go, so he goes and lives in the forest of Hereth. And I really appreciate his obedience. He has lots of reasons to stay. And he has lots of reasons to be kind of upset at how things are going. But he realizes God is calling him, and so he goes. And I want to challenge you to do that yourself. Live into the call of God on your life. Because every single one of you, there is a call of God on your life. God has not called you to simply exist on planet Earth. He's called you to a mission. He's called you to a good work, and we are the church, and we have a purpose here in this world. And it's a dangerous purpose, by the way. You notice that God is not calling David into something that's easy, something that's comfortable. So I believe that he is also calling you into something that is not easy, something that is not comfortable. You have a dangerous calling if you are a child of God. Being a child of God does not mean the easy life. It means a hard life. And it's a calling that you need to take seriously. Maybe you're wondering, like, what's going to happen? Like, maybe I'm going to lose friends, or maybe I'm going to be made fun of, or maybe things are going to get awkward between me and somebody else from work, or between family members. Maybe it's something different. There is always a bunch of human reasons not to follow the call of God. David had lots of really good ones, including one that might keep us all inside, which is, I might die. There's only a few people in this room right now that know what the reality of I might die means, because I'm a Christian. And God is calling you, despite all of those things, to live for him. It's a dangerous calling. And if you believe in Jesus, you have a mission, and no human reason is good enough to stop you. We often celebrate the truth. If God is for us, then who can be against us? How does that come out in your day-to-day life? We get to live into the dangerous calling that we have as Christ's followers. All right, let's continue on in the passage. Verse 6. The news of David's arrival in Judah soon reached Saul. At the time, the king was sitting beneath the tamarisk tree on the hill of Gibeah, holding his spear. He's still holding that spear. You'd think he'd try something else. He's holding his spear and he's surrounded by his officers. And then now he goes in this little speech. You need to listen carefully. "Listen here, you men of Benjamin," Saul shouted to his officers when he heard the news. "Has that son of Jesse promised every one of you fields and vineyards? Has he promised to make you generals and captains in his army? Is that why you've conspired against me? For not one of you told me when my own son made a solemn pact with the son of Jesse. You're not even sorry for me. Think of it, my own son encouraging him to kill me as he is trying to do to this very day." Now let me ask you, we've studied this for the last 3 weeks. Did any of that actually happen? No, Jason, I love your expression. No. I love that you were listening. No, none of that happened. Like, it's amazing how Saul has talked himself into this weird, paranoid, self-pitying place. It's actually kind of embarrassing. He just, and I think his men know it. His men are just standing there taking it. No one knew that David and Jonathan made this pact. It was secret. We studied a lot about how that happened. And these men are standing there listening to their leader rant and rave about conspiracy theories and bribes and poor me, poor me. And I think that we need to take notice of this because, again, we see the effect of sin in a person's life if undealt with. If you've got intentional evil acts in your life as a believer and you're not dealing with them, they're going to warp you. They're going to change who you are. They're going to blind you to the work of the Holy Spirit. They're going to make you insensitive to his people. The damage just keeps on going. And if you have intentional sin in your life that you are not dealing with, maybe even these words that I'm speaking today, the words that you sing today, they'll have no effect on your heart. They don't change anything because your hearts are hard. And Saul's heart is hard. The effects of sin have taken him from this amazing person that he was to a tiny fraction, and a warped one at that. And speaking of the effects of sin and how it affects people, Doeg the Edomite speaks up. Take a look. "Doeg the Edomite, who was standing there with Saul's men, spoke up. 'When I was at Nob,' he said, 'I saw the son of Jesse talking to the priest, Ahimelech, son of Ahitub. Ahimelech consulted the Lord for him. Then he gave him food and the sword of Goliath the Philistine.'" Now go back. One page back, and look at 21, verse 7. "Doeg the Edomite, Saul's chief herdsman, was there that day, having been detained before the Lord." A really small, really quick, but I wonder if Doeg wasn't ticked off that he got detained before the Lord that day. I just don't know for sure because there's nothing there. But that's the only other place we see Doeg before this happens. And I wonder if he wasn't angry at the priests for detaining him that day and ambitious and listening to his king and all the things that his king is saying, because his king is saying it. Maybe Doeg has no idea about how false these charges are. Whatever. But he speaks up and some horrible things happen. Let's keep reading. Verse 11, "King Saul immediately sent for Ahimelech and all his family who served as priests at Nob. When they arrived, Saul shouted at him, 'Listen to me, you son of Ahitub.' 'What is it, my king?' Ahimelech asked. 'Why have you and the son of Jesse conspired against me?' Saul demanded. 'Why did you give him food and a sword? Why have you consulted God for him? Why have you encouraged him to kill me as he's trying to do this very day?' 'But sir,' Ahimelech replied, 'is anyone among all your servants as faithful as David, your son-in-law? Why, he's the captain of your bodyguard and a highly honored member of your household. This was certainly not the first time I'd consulted God for him. May the king not accuse me and my family in this matter, for I knew nothing at all about any plot against you.'" Because there wasn't one. "'You will surely die, Ahimelech, along with your entire family,' the king shouted, and he ordered his bodyguards, 'Kill these priests of the Lord, for they are allies and conspirators with David. They knew he was running away from me, but they didn't tell me.' But Saul's men refused to kill the Lord's priests. Then the king said to Doeg, 'You do it.' So Doeg the Edomite turned on them and killed them that day, 85 priests in all, still wearing their priestly garments. Then he went to Nob, the town of the priests, and killed the priest families, men and women, children and babies, and all the cattle, donkeys, sheep, and goats. Only Abiathar, one of the sons of Ahimelech, escaped and fled to David. When he told David that Saul had killed the priests of the Lord, David exclaimed, "I knew it. When I saw Doeg the Edomite there that day, I knew he was sure to tell Saul. Now I have caused the death of all your father's family. Stay here with me and don't be afraid. I will protect you with my own life, for the same person wants to kill us both." Well, this is horrible. This is probably the darkest, evilest thing that Saul has done in his life. In his whole career as the king of Israel, this is the worst. You know, even Saul's soldiers wouldn't do it. Isn't that something? You get an order, you follow it. But Saul's soldiers just said, "No, I can't do this. This is wrong. We can't do this." And so Saul gives a sword to his herdsman, and his herdsman goes to work. This is as close to a mafia-style hit in the movies than I've ever seen in the Bible. No one is left alive, women and children included. They killed their animals. This would have been an absolutely nation-rocking move. We can't miss that. That this event that happened at Gibeah would have affected the entire country of Israel. No one would have missed this, and everyone would have been terrified. This is the slaughter of the most defenseless and spiritually important class of people in the nation of Israel. It's gross, sinful, wrong, and it shows the nation who their king is now. It actually sets the tone for the rest of the passage, because now the nation is heartbroken and fearful of their king. It's still a lot like this Robin Hood story. The people know what's up, they're terrified, but they can do nothing except keep their heads down. It's an important fact to help us remember as we go forward. Notice again that because sin is ruling in Saul's heart, he pays no attention to rational argument. Sin blinds us to everything except what we see, what we think, what we want to do. Sin is master in Saul's heart. And I also want you to notice the compassion and the remorse of David. Now, we don't get a lot of the emotion in this, but I can almost guarantee you that both Abiathar and David are distraught and devastated at the slaughter of his family and for the country of Israel. And by the way, this is another example of that theme that I told you about those who seek, find. Abiathar fled to David. Saul can't find David, but Abiathar found David. Those that seek, find. I admire David's godly character. He shows compassion to the brokenhearted. He takes them in. And we'll see his heart for people in the next passage here. Let's keep reading chapter 23, verse 1. One day, the news came to David that the Philistines were at Keilah, stealing grain from the threshing floors. David asked the Lord, "Should I go and attack them?" "Yes, go and save Keilah," the Lord told him. But David's men said, "We're afraid, even here in Judah. We certainly don't want to go to Keilah to fight the whole Philistine army." So David asked the Lord again, and again the Lord replied, "Go down to Keilah, for I will help you conquer the Philistines." So God always champions the cause of the downtrodden, the orphan, the widow. And in this vein, we see David's character come out really strongly. He champions the cause of the downtrodden, the orphan, the widow. He learns Keilah's in trouble. The Philistines are stealing their grain. And the king's heart for his people comes out and he says, "We got to do something about this." And so he asks God. God says, "Yes, let's go." So he tells his men, and his men are like, "No. We're a little nervous about this, David." And so David actually respects that. And he goes back to the Lord and he says, "Lord, should we do this?" And the Lord says, "Yes." And so now the men know that this isn't just David's gut reaction that we're just going to go put ourselves in harm's way. They know that David is checking with the Lord on their behalf. I love that. He's not a dictator. He's a man who loves God and he wants his people to know that God is with them. So he goes and checks. And the Lord says, "Go and do it." And so they do. And it's high risk and it's high reward. So let's keep reading, 5 to 12. So David and his men went to Keilah. They slaughtered the Philistines and took their livestock and rescued the people of Keilah. Now when Abiathar, son of Ahimelech, fled to David at Keilah, he brought the ephod with him. Saul soon learned that David was at Keilah. Good, he exclaimed. We've got him now. God has handed him over to me, for he has trapped himself in a walled town. So Saul mobilized his entire army to march to Keilah and besiege David and his men. But David learned of Saul's plan and told Abiathar the priest to bring the ephod and ask the Lord what he should do. Then David prayed, O Lord, God of Israel, I have heard that Saul is planning to come and destroy Keilah because I am here. Will the leaders of Keilah betray me to him? And will Saul actually come as I have heard? O Lord, God of Israel, please tell me. Again, and the Lord said, he will come. And David asked, will the leaders of Keilah betray me and my men to Saul? And the Lord said, yes, they will betray you. This is a really neat portion of scripture because it shows us the contrast in these kings. Saul brings the biggest stick he can find. He mobilizes every single soldier to come and crush David. There we go. Now you're awake. I know it's late. We're getting there. McDonald's is waiting for you. So David consults the Lord over this. Because he doesn't bring the biggest hammer. He doesn't try to figure out the best strategy. He just says, God, what should I do? Is Saul actually going to come? God says, yes. And is Keilah actually going to betray me? God says, yep. How did he do that with this ephod? So the ephod is something that we are not really familiar with, but it's a priestly garment that has pockets in it. And these pockets have the Urim and the Thummim, which are very important stones in the Torah. They're the yes and the no stones. All right, so you ask a question, and in the Torah, the Bible says God will honor this. Is it yes or is it no? And so this is an actual revelatory approved thing. It's not a godly coin flip, all right? It's not a magic eight ball. It's what God said to do when you needed to know his will. And so he asks God, and God says, yes, Saul is coming, and yes, you will be betrayed. And so for the sake of Keilah, David leaves. He knows that he's putting Keilah at risk. He's got to get out of there. For the sake of all the people that are there, he knows now what Saul is willing to do to punish people who aid him. And so he leaves Keilah, and on good terms. You'll notice that because in verse 13, it says, now David has 600 men. So now David has 200 more people than he did when he got to Keilah. Sure sign that Keilah is so grateful and that the men are so happy that he protected them that they joined up with David. Let's keep reading. David leaves Keilah with 600 more men and began roaming the countryside. Word soon reached Saul that David had escaped, so he didn't go to Keilah after all. David now stayed in the strongholds of the wilderness and in the hill country of Ziph. All right, so you see Ziph. It's quite a ways south of Keilah, right next to this big wilderness of Judah thing. And by the way, the wilderness of Judah, it's not the wilderness of your farm field, okay? Israel is not like that. Israel is mountainous and hilly. You know, if you're having trouble finding David, all you have to do is look outside onto a prairie. It's not too tough. But in Israel, it's all mountains. So he can hide very, very well out there. So he goes out there with 200 more men. Let's keep reading. One day, David stayed in the strongholds of the wilderness in the hill country of Ziph. Saul hunted him day after day, but God didn't let Saul find him. One day near Horesh, David received the news that Saul was on the way to Ziph to search for him and kill him. Jonathan went to find David and encouraged him to stay strong in his faith in God. Don't be afraid, Jonathan reassured him. My father will never find you. You are going to be the next king of Israel, and I will be next to you, as my father Saul is well aware. So the two of them renewed their solemn pact before the Lord. Then Jonathan returned home while David stayed at Horesh. I find it so amazing to see the hand of the Lord in these details. 600 men is a big crew. It's not a little tiny army. It's not a strike force in the way we think of it. 600 guys that have to eat all the time, and there's no McDonald's down the road, so your food is on the hoof, right? So you're walking around, 600 of you, all right? 600 sets of footprints leaves a mark. 600 Big Macs on hooves leave a bigger mark, and there's all that other stuff that comes with animals. not to mention humans. How does Saul not find these guys? Like, what? Come on. But God is there, and God is hiding them, and it's such a miracle. And get this, when Jonathan, who's friendly to David, he just walks on up. Dave, I found you. No one else did. I love it. It's just God is just so evident in that. He's so present. He's hiding David from a massive army. And yet when the number two guy in the army wants to go find David and do something nice for him, God's like, oh, sure, he's just over here. And you can find him. If you ever doubt that the Lord is involved in your life to the nth degree, don't doubt it here, that he can hide 600 guys and 600 maybe animals and all of their sign. He's there. He's in every single step of your life. And Jonathan finds David and encourages him. Probably something David needed. He maybe wondered where his friend was, what his friend was doing. And Jonathan says, you're still the guy. You're still the one. God still has a plan for you, and I'm going to be right there beside you. What an amazing picture of love for one another in the midst of tension and fear and risk. And what a great picture of the way the church needs to be. We're living very well. I say this every time. We are one day closer to the Lord coming back than we were yesterday. We're living in the end times farther than anybody has ever lived. And we have times of stress and times of danger and times of risk. And we're on a mission, just like David was. And God is right there with us. What an amazing picture of Jonathan coming alongside someone who's hurting, who needs reassurance. And he comes and he says, man, I still love you. You're still my brother. I'm still with you. And we're going to be together and we're going to be in front of everyone one day. That is us. We are the 600 guys. We are in this world. We are not of this world. We are fighting against the enemy all the time. He is roaming around this town looking for someone to devour. We are the 600 guys with David, right? We're the people that God has chosen, that he has set us apart. The church is that group of people. And so, merry men and women, are you engaged on the mission? I really hope that we've learned today that those who seek the Lord find him, absolutely, but that we have a role in this world, and that even though the world is falling apart at the seams and blowing apart at the other seams, and it seems like nothing that we believe the world cares about it anymore, that doesn't matter, because we have one another. And we have the Lord, and he is with us all the time, and he is emboldening us to carry out the work of Christ in this community. The enemy prowls around, just like Saul did, looking to kill, looking to damage, looking to destroy. But we're the community of Christ. We're the body of Christ. And he's given us one another, just like he gave Jonathan to David, to encourage, to care, to love. And then we take that love that we get from the Lord, and we encourage and care for and love and evangelize our community. We need to stay focused on that. We can't stay comfy in our strongholds. We've done that lots. The last 2 years, we were encouraged to stay comfortable in our strongholds. But we need to be out there. David was out there. And just in case you think, no, it's still time for me to be in my stronghold, let me just tell you right now that you're wrong. That this is not the time to batten down the hatches. This is the time to boldly preach the gospel to a world that desperately needs it, because we do not know the time. We do not know the hour. When the Lord Jesus comes again, we need to be ready. And that day is sooner than it was yesterday. And if we get to go to tomorrow, we'll be sooner again. The Lord has a role for us in this world. And a big part of that role is being a refuge for those who seek, a message of hope for those who haven't heard. Tim showed me a shirt the other day that popped up on his feed, which I thought was perfect. It said, "Normal isn't coming back, but Jesus is." Normal isn't coming back, but Jesus is. And if you have your smartphone, now it's heard it, and you're going to get an ad for it. Buy it. I'll call the elders forward. We're going to serve communion today for the first time in 2 years. We're excited about that. And we're going to partake in communion today. It's the first Sunday of the month. If you're not comfortable, there is a station at the back. You're welcome to go and take from that as well. Please do have grace for us as we stumble around trying to make sure all of you are served. We haven't done this in a long time, but it probably is like riding a bike. I was really glad to see the theme of those who seek find come out in today's message, because we get to celebrate together as a church today, and it's a perfect theme to do that. We see David operating in love towards his people on a large and a small scale, exactly like the Lord Jesus. The word says that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That's Jesus' love for us on a global scale. But we also see Jesus loving us on an individual scale, healing people who are sick, casting demons out of those who are oppressed, just sitting down for a talk with a Pharisee in the middle of the night when he's tired and he could be sleeping. That's what the context of John 3:16 is, God's love for the world, but also pictured God's love for an individual who is seeking truth. And Jesus cares for you. He says that if you seek him with all your heart, you will find him. Jesus is where true life is and where true meaning is, and pursuing anything else in this life is a waste of your time. If Abiathar had gone anywhere else other than David, he would likely have been killed as a David sympathizer by Saul at some point. But he ran and he clung to the true king. And that is all I see when I see David, I see Jesus in this case. Where David was a refuge for those who were seeking, Jesus is that refuge for you. If you know him and love him, praise the Lord and enjoy communion together. If you don't know Jesus, or you're hanging on to intentional sin right now, I would encourage you to think about what we're doing, but not participate. Because you need to deal with that. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5 that if you know of something that's preventing you from worshiping, go and deal with that thing before you come to the altar. And this ceremony, this sacrament, is for people who believe in Christ, who have him as their Savior. Please take it in a way that is right, not just because everyone else is doing it. These elements that we take today are symbols of how much Christ loves you. His body that was broken and his blood that was shed. So I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to ask the elders to pass out the bread. And I'd encourage you to unwrap it as you get it. And then wait until we all have it and we'll partake together. Lord Jesus, we love you. We are so grateful for your work on the cross. Lord, we're so grateful that you are a refuge for those who are seeking. And Lord, we need you even more now than we ever have, because we're closer to the end now than we ever have been. Let us cling to you, Lord. Help us to look to you for the wisdom that we need. Help us to look to you for the strength that we need. Lord, not to ourselves, not to anything else. Thank you for being the refuge that you are. And thank you for this picture of David, who is a symbol of what you were going to be for the whole world. Lord, as we remember your body and your blood today, please bless us. Please fill us with joy. We love you. In your name, amen.